Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming out to the community meeting on the Goose Creek Coordinated Study. A couple quick announcements. Restrooms are through those glass doors to the left. I would like to thank everybody for coming out and for your patience with this study. We're going to have a brief presentation by the consultant team. Cynthia Bowen with REA is going to kick it off, and then Colin McAweeney with Tischler Bice is also going to present some information. And then Brandon Denny with CDM Smith will talk about the transportation impacts. I would also like to recognize, I see several aldermen in the room, Alderman Baggett, Alderman Brown, Alderman Peterson, and am I forgetting? Yes, Alderman Potts. Thank you, sir. So we have comment cards in a sign-in sheet, so please sign in. Put your email address if you're not on the distribution list already. And can't emphasize enough to go ahead and fill out a comment card and go ahead and turn that in the basket out front. And we also have an interactive, if you prefer to do something online, we have an interactive map that the consultant updated today on the project webpage, so you can put your comment in on that. So I'll turn it over to Cynthia.
Thank you, Andrew, and good evening to everyone. We also have sticky notes out on the table, so if you'd prefer to put a sticky note out there, and there is a fly that has landed on my face. If you prefer to put a sticky note on the board, that is perfectly fine as well. But we do ask that you please leave us a comment either online or on the comment cards. That will help us greatly. But we will be here after the presentation, all of us consultants, the staff, to answer any additional questions. So these are our partners, myself from REA, as well as CDM Smith, who has handled all of the traffic analysis and traffic modeling, and then Tischler Bice, who has done all of the market study and financial analysis. So I thank my partners in crime, who we have been over the data and back and forth during this entire study. So tonight, I'm going to go a little bit over the process, talk about the flyover concept, the partial interchange, and then talk about next steps of where we go from here. So a little bit about the process. So you can see here, our main study area boundary is the kind of smaller red box that you see. That is what we looked at for the land use and the utilities area. And then the larger dashed red line is what we looked at for the transportation impacts, knowing that those impacts are oftentimes much greater and go farther out than what we see in terms of land use. So whenever we undertake a study, there are really three things that we look at. What does the community support? What does the market support, and what does the site support? And oftentimes, it's the intersection of those three things is where we find ourselves with our recommendations. Now, I will say that this particular study area is a much, much more difficult study area than what we find in most due to topographical constraints, site constraints, transportation constraints, and the like. So it makes, us and what we have to do in our job a lot more difficult and a lot more sensitive, especially because we have a lot of people who very much care about what's going on with their property and very invested and interested in that. So we have a four-phased process here. We started this back in November of last year and started in the discovery phase. We went through and did visioning from January through April, so we had a community meeting during that time, also some focus groups, and that's when we started to build our scenarios. Then from April through October, we started doing several different land use concepts. And then from July and then through December, we have started to work on the technical memorandum, but we are certainly not completed with that. That is why we're here at tonight's meeting. So, when we talk about these frameworks and running these scenarios, what does that mean? Well, it's an iterative process. We start with looking at the land use and developing the land use based on what the market says, and talking with you all and finding out what you want. So then we start to look at building out the density and looking at how that density would be phased over time. And so we pass that off to Brandon and his team, and they start to put that into the transportation model and start to run that model. And it starts to spit out that results. And so we meet with the city and talk about what those results mean. What does that mean in terms of transportation? What does that mean in terms of the intersections? How long are you going to have to wait at the intersection? What does that mean for safety? How is that going to be impacted? And so we determine if that level of service is going to be okay and what type of improvements that means that the city would have to make or developers would have to do if they were bringing in a project. And if we believe it meets a certain threshold that's a no-go, then we have to come back and start from the beginning and revise our land use scenarios. And so we've done this numerous times over since April all the way up until this time, until we've gotten to the design concepts that you see here. So I know several people have asked me, you know, why have we seen changes in the land use? And that is why. So back when we were here in May of 26, we had stakeholder meetings. And so, you know, what did we hear from those stakeholder meetings? Well, first, we heard that the proposed densities for the development should be higher, that there was a general support for the step-down transition from the interstate to the edge of the UGB, that people were not supportive of single-use multifamily development. I will answer some questions when we get to the end. Future uses should be compatible with and supportive of approved development that has already been approved and in the system entitled. Generally, people were not supportive of low density single family due to the cost of services. That we wanted to ensure that development along Pratt Lane and Carruthers Parkway was more pedestrian focused. And that development along Carruthers should keep people here in the area and instead of kind of going out into other places to seek other services or other employment. And this presentation will be made available on the city's website after tonight. In the conservation areas, some folks supported the conservation areas. There were a lot of people along Pratt Lane where more than 50% of their property had been designated as conservation, were worried that it would negatively impact their property values and their ability to develop that property. In terms of transportation and the themes around transportation, they identified the timing of the interchange being too long, out there too far, and that the flyover may not provide enough relief to development in the area, and that we really needed a more creative approach to Pratt Lane and Carruthers Parkway. And then there are also fiscal considerations. You know, what were going to be the impacts on the police, fire, and school services from all this development? How was the development going to be paid for? And then what was going to happen, what were going to be the tax impacts on the community? So those were some of the comments that we heard from the stakeholders. Now, what you are looking at here is an estimated of the 2030 traffic conditions just from the existing and approved developments. And what the red line shows with the red dots is that even with the approved development on the ground now, is that there is excessive queuing time and queuing lengths, and there's already a system where that the level of service is not being met with the development that's out there now. And so one of the things that we are trying to avoid now is what you see along Murfreesboro Road with the peak PM times at this point in time. So we're trying to avoid that condition as we're working our way through these recommendations. So with that, what I want to do now is turn it over to Colin, who's going to talk about the financial considerations that were taken into account as we developed some of the recommendations for the transportation system and the land use. Colin?
Evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out. Again, Colin McWeeny with the firm Tischler Buys, part of the consultant team here. Before going through really the nuts and bolts, the dollars and cents of our analysis, I wanted to illustrate here the dilemma our elected officials have to deal with when they're deciding on capital financing. And so this figure here on the left, or sorry, in the middle, is a number of different revenue sources. So you have your sales tax, property tax, all the way up to area-specific assessments. Now, on the left-hand side is sort of a continuum of the nexus, or the connection between the fee payer or the revenue, where the revenue source is coming from, and the benefit of that capital. So you're seeing as we go from sales tax all the way up to area-specific assessments, so those are special districts, let's say, right? So there's a certain area, you know, square mile, that is paying a certain assessment to go towards new infrastructure. So that's a small area. There's a strong connection between the folks that are paying the extra revenue, the extra costs, and receiving a benefit from that new infrastructure. Unfortunately, on the right, you're seeing another continuum, and that's basically the size of that geography. So we go from sales tax and property tax, which everyone's paying, and then up to, again, that area-specific assessments. And as that pool shrinks, that geography shrinks, so does the increasing of the cost to the residents within that area. A similar dilemma, too, that was on the capital side. This is on the operating and services that are provided by the community. On the top here of the continuum, you're seeing examples of services here for police that would be recommended for 100% funded through the tax base. Those are services that are providing sort of a benefit to all of the city residents. And then that works its way down to 100% cost recovery through fees. And those are examples like development services, where you have one individual who's getting a benefit, and those sort of services would be recommended to be recovered through those fees. So we have two scenarios, and we'll speak to those a little bit further, but there's an interchange scenario and a flyover scenario. Saying scenarios here because no one here has a crystal ball, and what we're doing is looking at a 30-year build-out. So all of the developable land in Goose Creek Basin, we apply those density factors to estimate the number of single-family, multifamily homes, the non-residential square footage, and then the population and jobs from that. So on the interchange, we have a little bit more development and a little higher density. So you're seeing 1,500 single-family homes and 2,900 multifamily homes. That's going to generate nearly 10,000 residents. And compared to the population last year, that would be an increase of 11% in the overall city population. On the non-residential side, you're seeing about 1.5 million square feet of new commercial space. So that's a retail, the office, and some expo and institutional development. That's generating nearly 4,000 jobs, or about 5% from where we are today. Here's a graph of the population and job growth. I'm sure you've seen the diagrams out in the hallway that shows the short-term, mid-term, and long-term growth scenarios. So you're seeing population pick up and hitting nearly the 20, at year 20, slowing down, finally reaching sort of build out of residential development. And then on the right figure is employment. So you're seeing growth there through year 20 as well. So in our analysis, we wanted to look at the specific capital revenues that the city has today to help finance new infrastructure. Right now they're collecting a specific property tax to service debt that was issued for new capital. There's a dedicated sales tax that they're using for new capital. There's road impact fees and park impact fees, which are one-time payments that new construction pays to offset their demand on new infrastructure. And then there's also the city facility tax. In the interchange scenario, that totals over the 30 years, $127 million. And we have slightly less development in the flyover scenario. So we have $110 million coming from those specifically for capital expenditures. We broke that down a little bit further to look at road financing. So you're seeing the debt service, property tax, sales tax, and road impact fees could all be used to finance new roads within the Goose Creek Basin. So that's at about $82 million in the interchange scenario and $74 million in the flyover scenario. Then the engineering team worked through the needed road infrastructure to support that growth in Goose Creek Basin, specifically in that area. And I think we have 10 or 11 projects here. In the interchange scenario, that's $217 million. And similar, actually, in the flyover scenario, we have the same cost, except the phasing is different because growth is slightly slow in the flyover scenario. Additionally, what we haven't included here in the interchange scenario is the cost for the specific interchange. Hopefully that would be provided by the state or federal dollars as well, but that's actually another cost that we haven't included here. So this figure compares that available capital revenue for roads to the transportation capital costs. So you're gonna see at the bottom there in the interchange scenario, we're in the red, $134 million in the interchange scenario and $143 million in the flyover scenario. Here's some timelines of what that looks like. So the green is the revenue, red is the cost, and then the blue line at the bottom there is the cumulative funding gap for the first scenario for the flyover scenario. Similar looking graph here for the interchange scenario. And I'll pass that over to Cynthia here.
Thank you, Colin. Okay, so now we're gonna talk a little bit into more specifics about each of the different scenarios. So first we'll go into the land use concepts, then we'll talk about the transportation improvements, and then again summarize the financial impacts. So the first concept is the flyover concept. And you see here, we have the design concept with the regional commerce that you see in the dark purple and the neighborhood mixed use you see in the lighter purple with the mixed residential in a kind of a little bit darker yellow and then the rest of the area in a single family residential. And then you have conservation subdivision in the kind of lighter green and the conservation area in the darker green. So with this particular concept, we have roughly 3,300 dwelling units with non-residential square footage of about 1.5 million square feet. So in this particular concept, it didn't matter how many times we changed the density, how many times we changed the number of housing, we really could not make the numbers work where it impacted the transportation network tremendously. And so staff and our consultant team do not recommend this option because we could not make any of the transportation improvements work. Even though we tried to scale back the density and limit development, we just could not impact or could not address the infrastructure deficiencies that were being created by the density that we were seeing or that we were creating from our land use concepts. You know, even when we tried to change the phasing of the development, that still was not impacting and was not helping the transportation situation. So to explain that a little bit more, I'll have Brandon from CDM Smith come up and talk a little bit about what we were seeing from the transportation side.
Hi, everyone. So the fun part now is to tell you what your traffic might be like. As Cynthia said, we went through this concept and realized that it likely will not work, so I will not go through a lot of the gory details with you, but I want to give you an overview so you will understand as we go through the next concept what's proposed. So this concept, the flyover concept, this involves a new roadway on the eastern side, going from Carruthers Parkway all the way south, crossing over the interstate, and then connecting with Lewisburg over on the west. And that roadway will cross over the interstate and not have any connection, so there's no new access or no new places for you to get onto the interstate to travel. That involves several new intersections connecting to existing roadways, as well as extending Goose Creek Parkway to the east, and you'll have some widening to Pratt Lane. In this concept, you have the opportunity to travel to the south if you want to either connect to 840 to use that interstate connection to travel, or if you're just going to a local roadway connection in the southern area, you can avoid the existing Goose Creek interchange up in the north, and specifically you wouldn't have to travel up and around in order to get somewhere. What we found though is that while that can be an attractive option, can alleviate some of the traffic, it doesn't necessarily, with the additional development that was put into this area, it doesn't necessarily really draw enough of it away. So what I have shown here is that three sort of categories of the type of experience you would have in driving this roadway. The red dots are supposed to represent places where you will not like to be there. That's a place that everybody's going to know. That's an intersection you want to avoid. Yellow is a place where it's close to meeting or close to exceeding the criteria that your city has developed as a standard for what is acceptable service. And then green means that you're okay, you're fine, you're going to be good conditions for you to drive through. So as you can see on the eastern side, most of this new roadway is not so heavily impacted by all of the additional development traffic that you would have some issues. And then as you move towards the interstate, there's still some problems that will be there with the additional approved developments that are already on the books. The images to the right, number one and number two, is where I'm actually pointing out these specific places where it's not just a general concern about the traffic operations. These are the places where in discussions with the city, these particular movements are likely to exceed, or very likely to exceed, the agreed upon idea of what people will accept in terms of driving in the Franklin area. So, at the Goose Creek 665 interchange, coming off of Goose Creek, people trying to go towards to the west. That movement is going to be very heavily impacted. Getting off at the northbound interchange or intersection is also going to be very heavily impacted. And anyone trying to turn from the interior section onto the interstate is going to be very heavily impacted. So you can see that essentially commuter traffic, traveling from this area to destinations outside of Franklin, they're going to have a large problem because a lot of the traffic is focused in this area as the point at which you'll be able to cross over the interstate to get to your destination. Also, the Goose Creek at Long Lane intersection, which is the southern connection, would be the point at which the Reams-Fleming development attaches to Goose Creek Parkway, and then on the other side is Long Lane. That approach is also expected to be very heavily impacted, likely very, very bad conditions, even with all of the access that whole entire development has to Paytonsville Road and Pratt Lane. One of the other things I wanted to mention is that the process of analyzing this traffic also involved not necessarily full-on geometric analysis. I didn't design new intersections, but I did still need to figure out how many lanes might you need for this type of traffic impact. And a lot of these intersections are very large. So the new roadway, for example, is proposed to be two lanes in each direction. It's supposed to be an arterial roadway. You're supposed to get on it and travel fast. But it's going to take, in some places, multiple turn lanes and all approaches. And as you can see here, we even have a couple points where You actually need three left turn lanes to handle the amount of traffic that is essentially trying to either get to the interchange or get to the west. So you can see Cynthia had mentioned earlier is that the Goose Creek Parkway is likely going to have some issues as you get into 2030. But even with this new development and the flyover concept, you can't necessarily alleviate all of that. What I'm trying to show you here is just a different way of looking at that. You have the analysis that we do looks at just a static picture of the intersection. I'm also trying to show that you can have some buildup over your times and your peak hours of travel. Basically, when you're trying to go to and from work in the morning and the evening, sometimes you'll wait at a light. You might get through. Maybe you skip one signal, but you get through the next one, right? Well, as you go along and people don't get through the light, that's going to keep stacking up and keep everybody's going to build up through that inefficiency. And what these lines here are supposed to indicate is that these are the points in this corridor where that's probably going to be a pretty big problem. You're going to be very congested. And in some cases, even with the fact that we implemented, for example, at the Paytonsville and Goose Creek intersection, implementing a triple left turn lane, estimated operation of the signal, you likely still could queue very significantly just with the amount of traffic that should be that's thought to go through that area. So here, this is just to give you an idea of the difference between what you can expect just with the approved developments, the Berry Farms development, building all of that out, the Southbrook development, the Chadwell, finishing out Reams Fleming. You can see that there are likely going to be some issues on Goose Creek, potentially some issues with the Reams Fleming traffic as it heads towards Paytonsville Road. Some of that can be alleviated with the redistribution of traffic to the flyover, and particularly for that intersection, and with the redevelopment of that intersection. But you can see even in the future, you might be able to get slightly better by allowing people to get across the interstate down there in the south, but it likely will still be a problem. So that is what I want to leave you with, and I'll hand it back over to Colin.
Hi again. So just in summary on the fiscal impacts of the flyover concept, for just looking at capital revenue over the 30-year build-out, that's $110 million, and then $74 million of that being for road projects that we were just discussing. So we're getting a funding gap here of $143 million. One thing I didn't mention is there's a number of ways that we can fill this gap through public-private partnerships, looking at other revenue sources that we don't currently have right now, or increasing our fees and raising specific taxes to help cover that gap.
Okay, so let's move on to the partial interchange. So the partial interchange concept, we were able to increase the density on this particular concept, and it was able to support the traffic a lot better than the previous concept. So there were some changes that we made here. We increased the neighborhood mixed use, which you see in the light purple, down and especially around the interchange, the proposed partial interchange in Carruthers Parkway. We added in some multifamily residential in and around Paytonsville Road and Carruthers Parkway, and then also again up in Carruthers and in Paytonsville Road as well. And then we increased the mixed residential in this particular concept, and then lowered some of the single family residential. So in this concept, we were able to increase the dwelling units to just over 4,500 dwelling units, while the non-residential square footage stayed the same. So generally, the staff and the consulting team supported this particular concept over the other concept because we were able to make the transportation improvements work. We're able to get increased densities, which is what you want to see when you're making so many transportation movements. There were still minor deficiencies in the transportation network, which I'm going to now have Brandon kind of to walk you through. I'm going to talk about phasing a little bit before we do that. So the other thing that we did look at is the phasing of this. So short-term, mid-term, and long-term phasing of this. There are, and again, this is a snapshot in time based on what we know. This is based on how development trends are going. It's based on the construction of the transportation network. So the transportation improvements the city makes, the transportation improvements that developers make. And so, you know, obviously with a lot of the development going in along Goose Creek Parkway, those transportation and that development along those areas are going to be in the short-term range. So you have areas along kind of Pratt Lane and Carruthers Parkway that are going to be more in the midterm range, whereas things kind of south around there and around the partial interchange, which are going to be long-term range, meaning 30 years plus. Now, the one caveat to this is if Pratt Lane develops sooner, that could change the phasing of this. So that is the one caveat that we have to this. So this is still, as we say, a snapshot in time. So with that, Brandon, if you want to now kind of walk our audience and our people at home kind of through the changes in the transportation network under this scenario, that would be great. Thank you.
Okay, so what is different this time? Essentially, the roadway network and the intersections, they're all fairly similar to what we studied in the flyover concept. The three big changes are that, now obviously you have a partial interchange, and what that means is that you can travel to and from the north. So when you get down to the partial interchange in the south, you can get on the I-65 northbound, or if you're coming from out of town, you can get on come from I-65 southbound and get off in that interchange and go wherever you like. The other difference is that earlier I had pointed out a couple of intersections were needing triple left turn lanes in order to handle the amount of traffic that is expected to be traveling up to Goose Creek. In this case, you could reduce that by one lane. So at the Long Lane Reams-Fleming intersection and at the new Paytonsville-Goose Creek intersection, you can reduce that by one lane and still likely be able to handle the capacity of traffic. In this case, you also, so the main point to pull from this new concept is that you can now draw some traffic away from the existing I-65 and Goose Creek interchange, and that does help out the Goose Creek roadway, as well as some of the intersections at the interchange and Long Lane. Now, I'm still showing those red, it doesn't really look different, but trust me, it actually does, it gets better bad, you know, it gets quite not as bad as exactly, yeah, it's a technical term. There is an improvement. You are now sort of closer to a point at which it's more a matter of how I'm estimating things to happen, but it's likely still going to be an issue, but at the same time, the point is that you are able to alleviate some of the congestion concerns by drawing some of that traffic down to the south. Now, one thing that was not shown in the previous slides for the flyover is that the intersection down at the south at Pratt Lane and Carruthers Parkway, if people are traveling more to the south now to get to their destination and are using this interchange more, now that the size of that interchange is likely, that intersection, which I had already set up to be fairly large, may not be enough. There could be some capacity concerns there going into the future. But the interchange itself, a few of the intersections on Goose Creek, those have gone down to where they're in the realm of what your city is has in their guidelines as acceptable. And you can still see that the new intersections in road along the new roadway should be good. Again, what I wanted to point out is the one point where you will likely be beyond what anyone would agree is acceptable is still going to be the I-65 intersection interchange. Here, you just still have a problem with the southbound right turn. There's probably still going to be a lot of traffic that needs to go that way, and you can't replace it by going down to the southern interchange, and then people getting on to that same exact point. So, even though we've built a new interchange, doesn't necessarily mean people aren't going to want to to go up there and use it. What can your, so again, this is the, what is it going to look like queuing wise, potential of traffic building up as your system is overloaded. There, even though we're showing that you're at the on Goose Creek Parkway, we're showing where I said that you are in a capacity, you're at a point where you're acceptable by your standards. There could still be some problems with basically, you know, similar to the picture that we showed of Murfreesboro Road earlier. People, there's going to be a lot of traffic and people could be queuing up in there and you could be waiting through a couple of cycles to get places. The queuing dissipates somewhat on Paytonsville Road because now you can take some of that traffic and move them down to the south more. But then, as you can see, that builds up on the Pratt Lane and Carruthers Parkway intersection. So, and then as far as the actual interchange, again, this is not a design concept. They are not at that stage yet. I just took a stab at what I thought would be an acceptable interchange. And there's a certain level of traffic shifting down to that point that it's going to be able to handle, too. Could be some issues if everybody floods down to that side. And then taking a look again at what that looks like compared to 2030, you can see that it could be better than what having that partial interchange down in the south could alleviate some of the problems. It just doesn't make it all good. So that is essentially the gist of the new interchange. And I'm going to turn it back over to Colin.
So you'll notice we're dealing with pretty similar construction costs for roads in both of these scenarios or concepts. But in the interchange scenario, in the purple column there, we do get a little bit more development. There's a bit more density. So we're able to collect more in revenues. Still in the red, but it's $135 million. So slightly less than the flyover. Slightly better, bad.
Okay, so rounding home. All right, so for each of these design concepts, we've put together some special considerations that talk about the development conditions and parameters under which development could occur for each of the design concepts. So we have those out there on the boards for you all to look at. These are policy recommendations that have been tailored for each of these development concepts. So we are seeking feedback from you all, whether you're online or here in the room. So please, you know, give us your comments on those. We will then refine these based on that feedback from you as well as from BOMA and the Plan Commission. So where do we go from here? So our next steps are, you know, we have BOMA and the joint workshop with BOMA and the Plan Commission tomorrow night. So we will be giving a very similar presentation to them. We will prepare the technical memorandum, and then we will be back here at a board meeting in December to present this to them. This is not a memorandum that, as far as I know, gets adopted. It's more of just a technical memorandum that will guide information to in the update to Envision Franklin. So with that, I will now open it up for questions. Now what I will ask is if you have a specific question on your property or whatnot, you know, please let's wait till we all, our staff are out there. The consultants is us, we're out there. We can answer that for you. But, you know, please, if you have general questions for the whole room and the whole public, then you know, please, let's hear them. So, yes, I will need to repeat the question so the people online, and I'm going to kind of point. So everybody kind of raise your hands, and I'll point and start calling them off. So this gentleman right here. Okay, so this gentleman wants to know what is the time frame for the Carruthers expansion from Goose Creek. Jimmy, can you answer this question? Let me go back to a map. Where we might, here.
That's good.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm Jimmy Wiseman with our engineering department here at the City of Franklin. Most of the new roadways, if not all of them, are contingent on development of property. So the city does not have any plans on the CIP, our capital improvement plan, to go out and build these new roadways, obviously, if there's no one to serve or to be served by the roadway. So it's contingent on development. I believe this was in more of the midterm, if we have that map, probably the midterm, so the 10 to 20 year time frame. So just to, based on our estimate, it's probably that short to midterm time frame.
Okay, the gentleman in the green. And I'll get to everyone.
Thank you. So I'll speak loud, hopefully.
I'll still have to repeat it.
So you spent a lot of time talking about these flyovers and interchanges that have big gaps in funding and are better bad from a traffic standpoint. A lot of data there. Good stuff, good data. What about the earlier slides where we talk about the stakeholders? You mentioned in May 26th there was a stakeholder meeting. Do you have the distribution of the stakeholders? You know, how many residents? How many people were businesses, developments? What's the distribution of that data that justified this increase in density that was one of your critical points that is driving this discussion?
Okay, so the question is, we have a lot of good information about density of numbers, about the traffic information numbers, but during our stakeholder meetings, what was the breakdown of our stakeholders, of our focus groups, and then how was that used to drive the density and the numbers for what we came out with the land use scenarios? So those were kind of two separate things. So the stakeholder list that we came up with was based on kind of, and Andrew, you may have to help me with this. If I remember correctly, it was based on the people and the businesses that were in the actual Goose Creek Basin area.
There were multiple stakeholder groups, and all of those notes are on the project web page.
Okay. So there were multiple stakeholder groups, and all of our stakeholder lists and notes are on the web page. Now, in terms of what drove the density, that was driven by the market analysis. So while we had the individuals request increased density, and we listened to what they said, what we did had more bearing on what the market would absorb and what the market would do. And then what the transportation system could support and what it would be able to bear. And so that was what was driving our decision making.
Yes, I don't understand. It said the slide, can you go back to
it? Yes, I can go back.
It says proposed density, so land use, are these like the guiding principles for your work?
No, these are just comments that stakeholders at the stakeholder meetings gave to us. They wanted the densities to be higher than what we had.
Okay. So the overwhelming number of stakeholders, the majority, is where you got that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The gentleman in the blue. And I know I got a couple over here and I got a couple over here. So did we do an analysis of what the density would be to cover the shortfall? So when you say cover the shortfall and the funding gap?
Yeah, the funding gap. So you had $134 million funding gap for infrastructure for the flyover. And good data in there. You had about $140 million, I thought, of funding gap for that reimbursement. The partial interchange is $134 million. Flyover was $140 million funding gap. Have you done any work large density increase would you need with a partial interchange to have a $0 funding cap?
So the gentleman, just so that for the people at home who are listening, was explaining that our funding gap numbers and then asking if we had done any analysis to determine how much density would we need to cover that funding gap. And no, the answer is no, we have not done that. Yeah, you can, Colin will elaborate on that.
Yeah, the short answer is no. It would be a sort of moving puzzle, because as you increase density, the transportation network, those costs might go up as well. So there's some sensitivity there, just sort of our analysis that I could speak to, but we don't know the hard numbers. Yeah, yeah.
But certainly not a one-to-one.
No, yeah.
Three additional lanes versus four.
Right, it would be an interesting analysis, because there is some capacity in certain areas in these concepts. So we potentially there might be a scenario where we could increase densities in other areas where there is capacity in the road network that we don't have to increase the cost, but we could capture more revenue. I don't know if we could get that number to zero though.
Okay, let me pick on this side of the room over here. This lady here, you in the front. Yes.
I wanted to make a comment and then I want to ask a question.
Okay.
When I was here in May at the May meeting, I asked who the stakeholders were, because we were told that the stakeholder meeting would be the next day. And the answer that was given to me was the businesses that would be involved. It said nothing about people who lived in the area. So I'm really wondering when that changed, because I was, one of the things that I and other people I talked to were miffed about was the fact that we are the stakeholders if we live in the area. We're the biggest stakeholders in terms of this is our land that is being disrupted. So I was really frustrated over that, but never in any of the correspondences that I have received from your offices have indicated that you were looking for any of us to participate as a stakeholder. So I'd like a better definition on that. And then the other thing is, when you think about how it all sounds wonderful, but how do we plan to pay for it? Well, you talked about the things and the ways we could pay for it, but the fact I want to know is, when would our taxes start to raise to start to bridge that gap? Because that will happen.
Okay. So the question is, when will the taxes raise to bridge that gap? And who are the stakeholders? Which I don't have the stakeholder list off the top of my head. I'll have to go back and to the website and make sure. I mean, I'll coordinate with Andrew, but we will follow up with you and make sure that we get that on there. Colin, do you want to answer the tax question?
Short answer is we don't know. long answer, there's a lot of policy decisions that go into play about raising taxes. There are certainly scenarios where, say, a benefit district is set up, and so those just living within the benefit district would pay an additional assessment one way or the other. They're pretty big numbers, so back to that first figure, right? If we have a smaller pool of people paying, that number per household goes up, yeah.
Can I ask one more quick question? And that was that we live in the county right now, but obviously it's on Pratt Lane, so it's obviously part of your demographic. And when did that get passed by the county? I mean, when did the county abandon us? Because we were not told that we were now part of Franklin City.
Okay, so the question is, so the question had to do with the urban growth boundary and the changes. So I will ask you to find Andrew over here after the meeting and have a conversation with him.
Okay.
So, because that's a really specific question, and he will have a conversation with you. Okay, I know someone over here, so we'll start right here. Will you put that on a comment card for me? Okay, thank you. Okay. Okay, so the question is the long lane overpass happening for both? Yes. Yes, it is. Okay, Kelly. Okay, thank you. So the question was, how accurate is our 10-year and 30-year traffic study? So Brandon, do you want to take this one?
So I do not have a statistic on exactly, you know, what the difference could be. I will say that in the process of doing this analysis and estimating the traffic, you know, we use a national guideline based on studies across the U.S. For how much these different types of developments will generate traffic. That's not necessarily specific to the Southeast or even, you know, your community. So I did work with the engineers here in town to try to tweak those numbers and make sure we were getting close to what they thought would happen. So I will say that after doing that work, I realized that the estimate for the 2030 traffic at your Berry Farms development, which is not finished yet, you're already hitting that, some of it, in 2019. So I would expect that this is likely not underestimating traffic. I also tried to get a gauge of based on there's some state data for your area, based on their patterns of traffic, and if I were to use that criteria and apply it to my estimate of what the traffic generation is gonna be, what would it look like, and that was still, I was still underestimating potentially. So again, I don't think that this will be overestimating. The big piece of this will be the matter of the stages of development and how people travel in the area. And again, I worked with the city to try to get as best an idea as I can about why people would choose to go where they go. I don't have a, you know, it is my profession. So I've got to do the best I can, but, without doing an after-action study, I really don't know. So there's not a lot of data, as far as I know, about that either. So.
Okay. Who would be anticipated in paying for any of the impact fees?
So who would be anticipated in paying the impact fees? So typically the developer would be the one that would pay the impact fees. Even for roadway.
For the flyover, for the interchanges?
The interchange is typically TDOT. Well, Jimmy, do you want to?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me let the engineer.
So, road impact fees are assessed when a building permit is pulled.
Okay, for a development.
For a new development. So, or a tear down and build a new home, something like that. So, and it's a one-time fee when the building permit is pulled. And those arterial or collector roadway impact fees can go to any arterial roadway in the city or any collector roadway in a certain quadrant of the city.
Okay. So the developers are not only paying for the impact fees for the developmental roads, but that the resources from that could also lead out over into major roadways.
Correct.
Okay,
let's make one comment and ask a question. I think the traffic analysis is underestimated there at the long lane crossover into Painesville, one of the two mm-hmm. it will I'm going to just, you know, without having any traffic analysis here, I would estimate 3 to 4 times Lewisburg Pike is going to be increased. And all that stuff right through there, Berry Farms and the park. My question.
Let me, for the audience. So the gentleman has just said that he thinks that the long lane traffic impact is significantly underestimated. And so I'm going to ask that you put that on a comment card for us, please. Okay, so now your question. I'm going to have to follow up with you on that, okay. And because I do not have that. I do not have that with me, so will you write that question down and with your information, and we'll get back with you on that.
All right.
Okay, thank you. Okay, yes.
If I understand correctly, the current situation is that transportation networks in a failure state.
Mm-hmm.
There's a huge funding gap to continue with either of these two proposals.
Mm-hmm.
There's independent of this area transportation study just recently done in Cool Springs that shows that it's in failure mode, and even mitigating factors we don't understand, mitigating action won't fix it. So obviously, if that was planned years ago to be okay, it's not okay today. So this may be kind of a crazy question, but who suffers if this area is not developed?
So the question is, with both scenarios showing that there's going to be traffic impacts and big funding gaps, with Cool Springs showing that its failure and mitigations are not working, if we don't develop this area, who suffers? Well, I think that's a matter of opinion. I think the people who own the property and what they may want to do with the property, I think it's their perspective and what they may want to do with their property.
So the people who are owning the properties would be developed, and I gather the developers who develop that property and make money through the process of doing the development.
Right.
So don't mean to be cynical, but it's
right.
A profit motivation on the part of the current property owners and developers that is causing the dynamic where transportation is going to get worse and there's a huge funding gap that could have been
passed. That is.
Can you repeat the question?
So what he's saying is that few benefit because, you know, property, because at the heart of it, property owners have the right to do what they want with their own property and to develop it. Within the constraints of what is required by the city. And so, okay. Is there any more questions? Yes.
There's been a whole lot of wonderful work, professional engineering analysis, you know, done on the financials and the traffic impacts. That's all well appreciated. And I guess most of us in here are neighbors. several of us have been negatively impacted by things such as conservation areas, where they're going, and what they're doing to property. And as much as I want to see it, and I'm sure the majority of everybody wants to see the pretty Williamson County stay pretty, there is going to be development. Now, your efforts to guide that have been great, have been wonderful. But to take it to the individual level, when you divide people's history, their life, work, paying mortgages, taxes, and you take that and reduce their property values so greatly by dividing and go away, it's not creating a win-win. The win-win on this entire project has got to be looked at further than traffic. Certainly, traffic's an issue, but as I heard said in one meeting, you know, people aren't exactly all stupid. If you are going to go somewhere and you know the Goose Creek Bridge is going to be impacted at 8 o'clock in the morning, well, okay, you leave early. My question would be, is there more consideration can be given to where the conservation areas go so that people who have a value of, on their land can benefit from that? Now, that's all got to be taken into account with everything else, all the other utilities and streets and roads, but we've got the structure for the win-win, which cannot exclude the individuals. And many people don't want the development, and I understand that. And like I said, most of us have paid for decades. Some people have been down Pratt Lane for 75 years. We've all invested in the life that we want, and this program project does not have to destroy that. It can build on that and add to the beauty and conservation, if you will, of that area. So, is there opportunities to change the conservation areas?
So, this gentleman has made a request about the conservation areas, how they were laid out, and if the policy has the ability to be changed. And Andrew, correct me if I'm wrong, but as I understand it, is a policy that BOMA has set. And so it's a policy that we would have to take up with BOMA to see if that policy could be changed. There's more to it, so let me have Andrew explain that.
We have conservation areas all over the city, all over the UGB. It's generally floodplains, floodways, and areas of steep slopes. So we've used slopes 20% or greater. That's the standard. So we looked at areas with slopes 20% or greater, as well as your forested hilltops in the area to try and preserve those, as we have across the city. But we are more than happy to take a close look at anybody's property like yours, sir. So just let us put down your address and your comment and your contact info, and we can be happy to sit down and we can look at it.
Thank you very
much. I want to know about a timeline for Goose Creek bypass and Goose Creek Parkway. Currently, Goose Creek bypass terminates at I-65.
So the question was, what is the timeline for Goose Creek Parkway and bypass? Jimmy? I am handing that one over to you.
So the timeline is similar to the extension south of Carruthers. None of these roads are necessarily needed until, I don't see where you are.
She's right back there in the red.
Oh, okay. None of these roadways are needed until development occurs. So, and these are large parcels of land, so in theory they would all develop in a systematic way. And this was actually more of the short and midterm on the map as well. So the development would build the road as it developed out. The city would not necessarily go in and build this road. The developer, as it's stated in our Connect Franklin document, so 11 to 20 years, something along those lines. And that's, again, the development could come in tomorrow or as soon as the study's adopted and say we're ready to move forward and we have a source of funding to do it, and then we would probably see that timeline move up. Oh, yeah. So the question is, when would Pratt Lane connect to Carruthers Parkway Extension? And let me go to, where's our map, our colored map? There, that's perfect. So that is the long-term connection as the flyover would be built. That's probably looking at a 30-plus year time frame. And again, this is all contingent on development as well. That's our assumption. It could happen sooner, but it would require a lot of infrastructure dollars.
I'm trying to figure out in my brain where that meetup would be.
So 840 is just at the bottom of the screen there. And if you'd like to catch me after, we can go into more detail if you'd like.
Okay, thanks. Yes.
So eminent domain is only something the board can approve. So when the board, if the city would go in and do that project, that is an option for the board. And it really is a state law that requires the city or municipality to pay at least fair market value for the property. So in a way it protects the property owner so they get the most value out of the land when it is purchased. And it would be purchased, not taken. That's correct.
Is that correct?
So the question is, if you wished, the only way for a property to be annexed is if you request it. I believe that is yes, but Andrew, you want to elaborate?
Yes, it is by property owner request, and there's also a mechanism to hold a referendum as well.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, in the back. No,
right now, can I go home? Everybody's dumping out of Bill Branch's place and those other big things in there. We got Wilson County tags, Rutherford County tags, Marshall County tags. They're all going paid for road. We're on 240. Paid for city road. So I can just see this turn that.
So the question is, did we give any consideration to Paytonsville Road outside the urban growth boundary? Brandon.
So the answer is no, sir. The essentially the study is limited to the urban growth boundary. That's just No, it's not that. Not that I don't care, but it's in terms of trying to limit the amount of things that I have to study. It's just the elements that are within the growth boundary that are a part of the Envision Franklin plan, the new roadways, and the subsequent intersections that would be built by those. So there was a discussion and with the city in terms of the amount of traffic that could be added to that direction. Yes, but in terms of actually studying that far south. So there was a, we did look into like how much traffic from these developments could travel in that direction, but not to the level of the same analysis that I did for the within the growth boundary area.
You understand what I'm saying, right? They're not running.
I do, yeah.
Left or right, going back up, waiting.
Mm-hmm.
Those orange dots, the next one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's without all this.
Yeah. No, that's a good comment. That's again, as Cynthia's been reiterating, that's a great thing to put down on a card because.
Please write it down on the card.
Yeah. That's something for the city to take into account as well.
And I'll add on to the city's jurisdiction really ends at the city limits. And as far as making improvements, that most of that is outside of the urban growth boundary. So at this current time, there's no opportunity for that property to be annexed into the city necessarily. So therefore, the city would likely not go out and spend taxpayer dollars or road impact fees outside of our jurisdiction. But I understand where you're coming from.
Can I just add one other question to that? I know it's outside of this project. Is something planned for Murfreesboro Road as well that would alleviate? I imagine there's a lot of people that are trying to find alternate routes that are going down, but would that be part of this that would alleviate the traffic as well?
So the question is there plans for improvements to Murfreesboro Road? And as you know, there's a TDOT project ongoing, and I believe that they will continue to, it's a state route, so they will look to spend dollars on that and make improvements as necessary. It is it's a great east-west connector that certainly can be utilized.
And isn't Goose Creek bypass a state road as well?
Goose Creek bypass is a state route as well, yes.
Thank you.
Okay, let's take a last couple of questions.
The question was about student enrollment in the study area, if future growth occurs, and we have talked to the school district. We've talked to their school planner. We've given her some of this information. So they are aware, and we'll stay in touch as it moves along. So the question was, how would any new schools be funded that might be needed as a result of this area? We have not.
Education.
I'm not aware of that. If they might be running those numbers, but I'm not sure.
Okay, last question. I can't, so the question was there any discussion or negotiation with a truck stop? I don't have any knowledge of that.
We have been contacted by Bucky's. They would like to put a flagship store there. No, I'm kidding.
Okay, Andrew, sit down. That is a public meeting. No, you know that. All right. With that, I'm glad we can end it on, I guess, a relatively high note of laughter. So I want to thank you all for your time and attention this evening and your great questions. We still will be around if you have further questions. We will be out here. We are going to leave the boards up this evening. We will be back here for the joint presentation or for the presentation for the joint workshop with BOMA and FMPC for tomorrow evening. So again, thank you all for your time and your attention. We greatly appreciate you. Have a good evening.